Pray together. Father, we come to you today to praise you that you are here, that anywhere believers are, you are there, because you indwell us, Heavenly Father, and you live inside of us and teach us the truths that are eternal. Thank you that you're here in this worship service today. Lord, if we don't feel you, we can't blame it on anybody else. It's because we are not either feeling you because of sin in our life, or our mind is focused on something besides you, or, Lord, we fear this is true with some, that some don't know you in the free pardon of sin. We pray, if that is true, that sinners like us, that they would find Jesus Christ and his grace and forgiveness precious to their own soul before it's too late. Lord, thank you for meeting here with us through the life of every believer. Thank you for each one of our guests that are here today. For those who would tune us in through the radio or television broadcast, and for those who are here and those working in other areas of the building this morning. Lord, keep us safe. And Lord, let fear not rule the day. But, Lord, let us worship you and encounter you in this place today. And, Lord, lift up the name of Jesus. For it's in his powerful and precious and holy and sweet name we pray. Amen. Amen. Good morning. Good to see you at the Lord's house today. We just had a great week this week. God's been good to us. Had good services last week. And the Lord added to our church. We want to welcome Charles and Lana, and we are so glad that Sunday night they came to join us and be a part of the body here that meets at 201 South Main Street. But God is good. We've got mission team members, had a commissioning service for them last Sunday night, and they have arrived safely in Honduras and already at work this morning and trying to hand out Jesus to some folks that don't know him in that part of the world. So you pray for them and lift them up in your prayers. And if you're our guest today, please accept our thanks for coming to worship with us. We love to have guests, and we welcome you and thank you for coming. And if you're here with a family member, just love on them. And as we keep hearing on the news time and time again, we don't know when the last time that we'll see a family member. Let's take advantage of every opportunity to do that through natural causes or through tragedy. we lose our family members. So let's love on them. Let's be biblical. Let's be family. And let's teach them about Jesus and prepare them for that ultimate day that all of us are going to be dispatched. We get hatched. We know we celebrate when babies are born, and someday we're going to get dispatched, aren't we? Out of this world to a world that's created for us if we're saved. But welcome, and we are so glad that you're here. Remember a couple of things. We're beginning a new series of sermons this morning, and it will be entitled, you'll hear more about it, Will the Real Church Stand Up? And then we're starting a book study tonight. The book was written by Dr. Tom Rainer. He is the president and CEO of Lifeway Christian Resources, the old Sunday School Board, and Dr. Rainer is a prolific writer and has been a pastor. He has sons that are pastors, we're going to start this book of his. It's been out a few years now, entitled, I Am a Church Member. And I couldn't encourage you enough that if you want to be understanding what it means to be a church member, and if you have an itch in your heart and a desire in your heart to work for the Lord through the local church, and you've never heard this book taught, you need to come for these six sessions. Now, we've got some previously scheduled things that's going to interrupt. You'll be getting a schedule of those services. It'll be on Facebook later. And the exact schedule of those six nights. And we want you to be here and hear, I am a church member. What does that mean to you? And let's just come back tonight at 6 o'clock. And so tonight and next Sunday night and some other Sunday nights in the month of August and early September, we're going to be looking at this book. I hope you'll be here for this series. So on Sunday morning, about the real church. On Sunday night, what it means to be a church member. That's going to be our focus for a couple of months. I hope that you will make that your focus as well. If you're going to be out of town on vacation, you can hear the sermons on the YouTube on our website. And if you can hear it, if you're going to be sick, if you're planning to be sick now, you can listen locally, okay? So God bless you. We're glad you're here. I want us to stand up and greet one another, and if we have guests here, be sure and greet them. We have some folks who are awaiting test results. Let's pray for them this week that God would give them peace and His joy, and some folks that are awaiting surgery. Pray that that gets to happen and God's will is done in their life. Thank you for being here. Let's pray for the sick, the homebound. Would you stand with me now and greet one another as we fellowship together? Even so, we see through a dark glass now, Lord. We look forward to the day that we will see you just as you are, face to face. We'll be able to worship you perfectly, while now we worship you imperfectly. But our heart is the same. We seek to encounter you here in our worship service this morning. And Lord, even as we've encountered you and been confronted once again with the fact that you loved us so much that you gave your Son to die in our place on the cross of Calvary, so it is, out of grateful remembrance and worship, we bring the first portion, the tithe and the offering, back to you to acknowledge you as the giver of all that is and the owner and stakeholder and deed holder of everything we have. We worship you now with this offering. Use it for your name's honor and glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen. Thank you, choir. Appreciate it. Musicians and Brother Robbie. Boy, it's good to be here. Some of my best memories, Brother Paul, are from childhood. I don't know if I can remember that better than yesterday for a reason or not. I don't know if there's a medical condition for that or if it's just advancing in years. But I remember a television show that my family would watch back then. It was safe to watch a lot of shows back then. But I remember sitting there with my family and in that little small living room on a sofa that wouldn't pass muster for most people today. But we used to watch a television show entitled To Tell the Truth. Now, is anybody here old enough to remember To Tell the Truth? Would you raise your hand up? Okay, a few. Now, I'm going to tell the rest of you about To Tell the Truth. It was an American panel show. That means they had panelists who were there watching the show. They were celebrities, and they would listen, and then they would get a vote at the end of the show. It was created by Bob Stewart. It was produced, I can still hear them say, by Goodson Todman Productions. It's aired in various forms since 1956. I know, back when the dinosaurs roamed the earth, right? Both on networks and in syndication on some cable channels. Three challengers are introduced, and they stand them up side by side. Three challengers, it could be women, it could be men, and they all claim to be the same person. And for instance, they would say, my name is Curtis Thompson. My name is Curtis Thompson. My name is Curtis Thompson. They would all say they were the same person. And the announcer typically asks the challengers who are standing side by side, what's your name? They'd say, my name is. And then the panelists would read along as the host of the show would read what was an affidavit signed by the real person of that name. It told about them and told why they were selected to be there, and they signed that affidavit about it being the truth. And the panelists then are all given a period of time to question the three people on the stage. Answer this question for me. Answer that question for me. And after questioning is complete, after the contestants have given their answers to the question of the panel votes on which of the challengers they believe is the real Curtis Thompson, for instance. And once the votes are in, the host says, will the real Curtis Thompson please stand up? And one would kind of feign and step forward and back, and the other two would do that, and finally, the real contestant would step forward to the applause of the audience. And you know, in today's world, there's a lot of organizations that claim to be the church. Just a lot of them. They've got church on their signs. They call themselves the church. But just like the game show, there's only one real church. Only one real church. And I believe that God is asking a question of the church in this contemporary day in which we live. And let's look at the question up on the screen. It's the title for the sermon series, Will the Real Church Please Stand Up? I'm convinced and convicted that it's time that the real church stands up in our world today. So I plan to preach this series of sermons, and I'm basing it on a book that was written by Dr. Paul Powell a long time ago, several years ago. It's going to be my attempt, these sermons will be, to answer that question. Will the real church please stand up? And I want to answer the question what the real church looks like. The real church is the only organization that Christ left on earth to carry out his work. And I make no apology for stating my conviction that anyone who wants to be involved in what God is doing in the world today needs to be wholeheartedly, 100% committed to the real church. The real church that Jesus left to evangelize the world, to disciple believers and to help people who are hurting. That's the real church. So Jesus loved the church. He loved the church so much that he gave his life on the cross for the church, for you and me. And so we should do the same. We must bring our life to Jesus and surrender it. We must pick up our cross daily, Jesus said, and carry it for the Lord's sake. And so our life needs to be surrendered to the Lord. Our home needs to be surrendered to the Lord. Our church needs to be surrendered to the Lord. And so Jesus loved us that much. We are supposed to love Jesus that much that we surrender our will to his will. And I believe that God is urgently pleading with individuals, with our homes, our families, and with congregations to cease being the imposters and help people. And he's saying, will the real church please stand up? So we begin today by looking at the church that Jesus left on earth when he ascended back into heaven. And although I preached from this very text last year, I need to preach from this same text again as the foundation stone for this series of sermons. So you bear with me. If some of the things I say sounds familiar, they will be. And you know what? They probably were familiar when I preached them the first time. But I want you to listen to this. Look at the next slide. The title of our sermon is The Real Church Got Off to a Rocky Start. The real church got off to a rocky start, Matthew 16:18. And so if you're physically able to do so today, would you please stand to honor the reading of the Word of God? Verse 18 of the 16th chapter of Matthew's Gospel. And the Lord said, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we do come to you today to thank you for the day you've given us. And Lord, we stand in awe, we stand in awe, we stand in awe of you. Because Lord, we can talk to you, we can pray, and Lord, miracle of miracles, we can hear you speak back to us through your word. And Lord, I just pray that you, Heavenly Father, the one who loved the church so much, that you died for the church, that God, you would speak to our hearts today, and that we would surrender our life, our home, and our church to the will of Jesus. Not our will, but the will of Jesus. Lord, that we can be the church that's built on the rock, that we can be the real church in the world today. Not just another imposter, but the real church. Lord, through this series of sermons and through this book study about being a church member, would you reshape my life and the life of every individual that are members of this church? Would you reshape our congregation into being a teaching and reaching, an evangelistic, missional, on mission church in the world today? And God, we'll give you the glory for it, because we know that if we allow the gospel to change us and we step up and become the real church, that it will influence and change our community. It will change our region. It will change our nation, and it will change our world. We pray that your will is done here today. Speak through your servant. Heal the brokenhearted. Encourage the discouraged. Heal the sick. Give hope to the hopeless. Give patience and peace to those awaiting test results and awaiting surgery. And God, give peace that passes all understanding and the comfort of the Holy Spirit to those who are grieving the loss of someone they loved so very much. Let us be the church. Speak through your under-shepherd today. We'll give you the glory, for it's in Jesus' name we ask, and amen. And you may be seated. As you might remember, or you may not, the context for this verse of Scripture, these verses, would be this, that Jesus had taken his disciples on a little retreat near Caesarea Philippi, and he asked the disciples this question. Let's look on the next slide, and he says, read that highlighted part with me, would you? Who do people say the Son of Man is? Who do people say the Son of Man is? And so, first of all, they shared the rumor mill. You know, there's always a rumor. That's how I know these are Baptists, these disciples. Amen? There's a little bit of a rumor mill. So what did they say? Look at the next slide with me. And it says, read the highlights with me. Some say John the Baptist. Others say Elijah. And still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And so they all had an opinion, and people are talking about who Jesus is. And so that's who they thought, the people thought he was. But Jesus wanted to know something more. He wanted to know what they thought as the disciples. Look at this next slide. But what about you, he asked, and then read it with me, please. Who do you say I am? Let's read again with the emphasis on you. Who do you say that I am? And then Peter spoke up first. He was kind of like that. He ran into the empty tomb first ahead of John. And you know, he was just always out front, always sometimes sticking both feet in his mouth. But Jesus said, who do you say I am? And he answered him. And this time he had a little different inspiration. Would you read the highlight part with me? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You know, I can just imagine if it had been a game show, the lights would have flashed, the applause would have roared, and confetti would have flown everywhere because Peter had a spiritual insight. Look at the next slide. Jesus replied to him, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, or Bar-Jonah, which means son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man. We've had a lot revealed to us by man, haven't we, even in our day. This was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. Then came the marvelous teaching about the church in verses 18 and 19. The word translated as church in our text today, whenever he says that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church, is that word, and you heard me say that last year when I looked at this text. It's the Greek word ekklesia, and it is translated as church. It means the called out ones. In the Old Testament scriptures, it referred to Israel, God's people, called out of slavery, brought out of Egypt, called out of Egypt to follow Moses to Canaan, to the promised land. In Greek culture, it became to be known as an assembly of citizens in the Greek city-states that made up the Greek world. And by the time that we get to this text, the word gradually had come to mean this Christian meaning an assembly of God's people, those called out to salvation and service in his kingdom. And so the church today, the ecclesia, is those who have been called out of sin and darkness. You once were darkness, Paul wrote, but you've been called into his light, John wrote in his gospel. Been called into his marvelous light. And so it comes to mean to you and me today that we are not just ordinary sojourners in this world, but that we have been called out of our sin and that way of living to follow Jesus and to serve him in his kingdom. I believe that Baptists have done a disservice to our people, that we have been so evangelistic-minded that we have forgotten to tell people that Jesus died on the cross not just to save us from hell, but he died on the cross to save us from hell if we would believe on him. But if we believe upon him, he's also called us to serve him through his church, service in his kingdom. So Jesus used some symbols to teach three, what I believe are very great truths about the real church that he planted. And let's look at the next slide. It tells us that the real church is founded on a powerful promise. And what is that promise? Let's look at the next slide and read that highlighted part with me, would you please? On this rock I will build my church. Now, pun intended, that's where I got my title for the sermon. The early church got a rocky start. Amen? You like that, don't you? I can tell. You're so alive with me this morning. All right. On this rock, I will build my church. And I mentioned last year when I talked about this, three common interpretations. One, some believe the church is founded on Peter, that Jesus is saying, I'm going to build my church on you. And therefore, apostolic succession began. And they still believe today that the Pope is a direct descendant of the Apostle Peter. And so some believe that Peter was the first head of the church and that the church was built on him. But there's yet others who believe the church is built on Peter and the other apostles, and that Peter's name change represents something a little bit different, that it was a change in his character, that it was just symbolic, that his character changed, and so Jesus changed his name. But I believe that the very best rendering of this text is teaching that the church is founded on Peter's confession that was based on spiritual insight, that he was inspired by the Word of God, and it was revealed truth to him that Jesus is the Christ. For you know what? I believe the only way you can be saved today is that the Holy Spirit reveals to you that Jesus is the Son of God, and that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man comes to the Father except that they are drawn by the Spirit and they believe on Jesus and they come through Jesus, the door into the sheepfold. Amen? That's the only way you can get there. And so I believe the best rendering is that Jesus, the faith that Peter talked about, his confession is what it was built on. It's built on the divinity then of Christ Jesus himself. And so Jesus Christ is God. The Bible tells us that Jesus became flesh and dwelt among men. And so he was very God and he is very God. He's not just God's representative. He was and he is God. And upon that foundation, Christianity and the church rest. And I ask you a question today. If you're listening by way of the radio or you're watching the television broadcast or if you're sitting in a pew at First Baptist Church in Oneida right now, I ask you, are you looking for God? If you're looking for God, I want to tell you where he can be found. He is found in his Son Jesus, who became flesh and who died on a cross for your sins and mine, and who was buried, and we'll get to it in a minute, but I can't wait. He came up from the dead, alive again, resurrected from the dead. And you can pray to him, you can talk to him, you can trust him to forgive your sin and to give you the gift of eternal life. He is the foundation. He's the rock that the church must be built on. I've said before that some try to build their church on the pastor's personality or gifts. And then when he either has a moral failure and is shamed, the church fails. Or when God calls him away or he makes a decision on his own to leave and moves away, then the church fails if you build the church on the pastor or the staff. But I want to tell you something. You cannot even build it on a program such as music. As important as music is to the church, as important as recreation is to the church, as important as fellowship is to the church, as important as student ministry and children's ministry is to the church, if the program fails, then the church fails. The church must be built on the foundation of Jesus Christ. Nothing else. Amen? Nothing else. And that's the first great truth that Jesus taught his disciples, that the real church is founded on a powerful promise that on this rock I will build my church. Also, we see on the next slide that the real church is called to an otherworldly work. Now, if there's one big mistake that I see us making in the world today with the church, and understand when I'm saying the church, I'm including this one with many others that make up the church, the real church in the world today. But if we're not careful, we try to maybe not intentionally, but we make the church an earthly organization, and we try to run it like a business. And we try to make it
something that it's not, because the real church is called to an otherworldly work. What do I mean by that? Well, let's look at the verse 19. Read that highlight part with me, would you? I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And look how he explains that. That whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Keys, and I think I stuck mine in here somewhere, there's a key that I usually have hidden. It's kind of covered up. You never see that key right there. But that key gives me access to something. And some of you know what it is, don't you? It's a key. My vehicle's got one of them push-button starts. And you don't have to have a key to start it, but you do have to have the key fob in your pocket. And you can get in the vehicle without that. But if the battery fails in that key fob, you can't even get in the vehicle. And so some wise person decided they put the key inside the key fob, and it latches on there. You've probably got one similar to it. But it's amazing, isn't it? That key right there will open the door. It'll open the hatch. It'll open the glove box. So if I want to hide all my money in the glove box, and my glove box would hold all my money and then some, I think, but put it in there and you twist it and until they take something to break it apart, that's the key that will give you access to it. So keys give you access to something or the opportunity to use something. If we preach the gospel, we give people access to the opportunity to be saved. If we teach in the gospel, if we're teaching to reach people in our Sunday school, if we're preaching to reach people in our churches, if everything that we do, our fall festival and our different outreach programs, if we're doing it to reach people, then we're giving them the keys to the kingdom, an opportunity to open a door and have access to salvation. So our mission then is to broadcast the opportunity, the knowledge of the Son of God, so that men and women and boys and girls everywhere, through turning from their sin and turning in trusting belief to Jesus Christ, have access to the cross of Jesus and may enter into His salvation. And the second part of that verse, we can translate it, we must do here on earth which the Lord has already purposed for us as the real church to do. He's already purposed that in heaven. So the purpose of the church then is to do the will of God on the earth. And we read in the Bible that the will of God is this, that no man, no woman, no boy or girl would be unsaved, that they would perish without Christ as their Savior. Did you know that the most important goal of the church is to reach every boy, every girl, every woman, every man, regardless of skin color, creed, culture, language they speak, whether they're on one side of a wall or another side of a wall, it really doesn't matter, that the gospel is for them. And that's God's purpose, that everyone may enter into His salvation. We know that's the will of God. If you don't believe it, don't stop with John 3:16. Read John 3:17 as well. For it's God's will that none should perish, but that all would come to eternal life. And the Bible clearly teaches us that. But many, if not most churches today, I've said on numerous occasions, have gotten confused about who they are in the world today. And they may or may not have lost their sense of mission and purpose decades ago. And they've stopped reaching out. Everything is inward. It's all about me. I've got to be happy, or I'll find a church where I can be happy, or I'll just get rid of the preacher where I can be happy at my church, or I can get rid of the deacon, or I can get rid of somebody so I can be happy at my church. I want to tell you something. The church is not about me, and it's not about you. It's about all the lostness and the darkness in the world, reaching them with the good news that Jesus died on the cross for them. And when a church stops seeking the lost, their sense of purpose and mission deteriorates and is lost. And at that point, the decline and death of the church begins to set in. Say, oh me. It does. Because like it or not, every one of us are going to die. Amen? You don't believe you're going to die, do you? Everybody's going to die. And we bury people all the time. I may be the next one out. If so, don't waste a lot of money on that. Spend it to reach other people for Jesus. Amen? I may be the next one out, Brother Pat, but I want to tell you something. We're all going to die. And churches decline and death sets in for churches when we lose our sense of mission and evangelism. So the real church is founded on a powerful promise. The real church is called to an otherworldly work. And finally this morning, and somebody said, finally, finally. But here it is. Look on the screen. The real church is designed for the ultimate victory. Aren't you glad you're on the winning team? Look at verse 18 again. Read that highlighted part with me. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. The gates of Hades won't overcome it. The word translated Hades here means death. And the idea is that no power, not even death, has the power to bring down the real church. Death can't stop the church. Jesus' next words to his disciples would be that he must go to the cross, but that even death would have no power over him. Look at verse 21 on this next slide and read that last part with me. And on the third day be raised alive. Hallelujah. Jesus was saying, I'm going to die. Read the first part of that verse. I'm going to die and be raised to new life, but that through all of that, the church would live on. The gates of death will not overcome the church. Persecution has continued all down through the history of the church. It continues today, Brother Jamie, but it has been said that the blood of the martyrs has become the seed of the church. The work has gone forward. Statistics say that more Christians died for their faith last century, the 20th century, than in the 19th previous centuries. Yet, yes, the gates of death have not prevailed against the real church. Jesus never said his church wouldn't have opposition. He didn't say that we'd never disagree with one another, but he said it would suffer no defeat. The real church cannot be defeated. There's always enemies. And he said the final and largest enemy to be overcome is death. And we shall come up against death itself. And as I stated the last time I preached this text, when death is finally dead, the church will still be alive. Amen. When the trumpet sounds and time shall be no more and death is taken and thrown into the fiery pit for all eternity, the church will still be alive. And all the church said, amen. So here's the question. Look at this next slide. Let's think about what we've talked about. The three great truths about the real church. The real church. First of all, the real church is founded on a powerful promise. And secondly, the real church is called to an otherworldly work. It's not just another organization. And the real church is designed for the ultimate victory. So regardless of how dark this world gets, regardless of how severe persecution becomes, the church will stand. And those who have been saved and those who have been connected their life through sacrificial, through the real church, are on the winning side of an epic battle. The victory will be won. So I ask you again on this final slide, will the real church please stand up? If God has spoken to your heart this morning, you know you're saved, and you want to work in the real church based on that rocky start, that rock, the confession of Peter, and you want to be a part of a church like that, I want to invite you to this altar to pray and commitment. You don't have to say a word to me, but I want to invite you to come and make that commitment to the Lord. Lead others to that commitment. And if you're here today and you've never been saved, your faith is not on the rock of Jesus. I want to invite you to come and be a part of the real church as you're born into the kingdom of God. through His Spirit that's calling you to Him right now. Would you stand with me, church? Will the real church please stand up? Will you respond to God's invitation to your heart and life today? The real church. Listen to Him. He's calling you. He's inviting you. Do you want to be a part of the real church? Speaking to you, with the real church, please stand up. Another verse. Is He speaking to you? Do you want to join the church? Do you want to be saved? Come this morning. Whatever God's saying to your heart, come. If you didn't feel led to come or fear knocked you out of coming to the front, would you just bow your head right now? And when you pray and pray your heart to God, if you've not already, would you just, if you want to be a part of the real church, if you want somehow to get the dynamic power, the dunamos, the dynamite of the Holy Spirit at work in your heart and life, to share Jesus, the gospel of Jesus, with people at work, in your neighborhood, at the ball field, on the walking track, on the trails, on vacation, at the restaurant, in the convenience store, in the supermarket, in the retail stores, wherever you're at school as it starts up in just a few days, if God's speaking to your heart, would you just speak to Him right now and make a decision? Make a decision. You want to be a part of the real church. Would you do that right now? Would you keep your head bowed for just a moment, every eye closed except myself? If you made that decision this morning, would you just encourage your pastor's heart and say, I've made that decision this morning, Brother Pastor. I'm raising my hand. Yes. Yes, I see those hands. See those hands. Thank you. Thank you. Put them right back down. Thank you. God bless. God sees your hands. God knows your decision. God will honor that. God will use us for His glory. Now, will you look at me just a moment? I tell you, I believe that God's wanting us spiritual awakening, not just in our church and community, not just in America, but around the world. I believe that with all my heart. And it's going to begin with somebody like you and me making a commitment to Christ, making a commitment to His Word, standing on the promises of Christ our Savior. And our invitation to Him was, I surrender all. Not just part, but all. If you want to know the joy of the Lord, if you want to know happiness beyond measure, if you want to feel at home in this world like it's impossible to any other way, if you want to be a part of the real church, surrender everything you are and ever hope to be to the Lord Jesus Christ and His Lordship in your life. He will lead you. He'll direct you. He'll give you the victory. He'll give the church the victory. Because I've read the end of the book, and the church is the victor. The darkness is not going to overcome the church. The church is the victor. And there'll be faith on earth when Jesus comes again. We don't want the Roger Ray. There'll be faith on earth when Jesus comes again. I don't know about you, but as for me and my house, I want to serve the Lord. Make that commitment. Be back tonight, 6 o'clock, and find out what that means in a personal way, that I am a church member, so what does that mean to me? I think you'll enjoy. I think you'll be blessed. I think God will use it victoriously in your life. Please come back tonight at 6 o'clock. If you want a book to read that first chapter, we were able to buy them at a volume discount. $5 a piece. You probably already read that on the front of the bulletin. We're going to ask Miss Colby and Miss Page. They're going to be out there. They've already been out there before church and got them on a little table right out here in the foyer. And if you'd like to have one, get one. If you can't afford one, you can have one anyway. And the church will take care of that, okay? And you just get it, and that'll be fine. Or if you don't want to tell them, you tell me after church. You need a book. We'll get you a book. All right? God bless you. Let's sing this song victoriously. Our closing hymn today. Guests, please come back and be with us. And let somebody get at each door. And let's greet all of our folks and welcome them back. Tell the good news that Jesus saves. And tell it in the community that we're looking for the real church at First Baptist in Oneida, Tennessee. Amen. Try it again. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, that's pretty good. All right, brother.